Hi, guys, big episode. This is Let's Talk About Myths, baby. I'm Liv, I'm crazy, I love Greek mythology more than I rationally should. How's it going? I've been trying to sort out a way to not give up all the famous awaited myths right off the bat and to spread them out, but this one is just calling to me and, you know, I'm on episode 15. It seems only appropriate. And I feel like some of you might have been waiting on this one too. First, big note up front. Today's story is about Heracles. See, that's his Greek name, his original name. Thing is, this Western world of ours has decided that this is not his name, and that his name is Hercules, and that that is somehow Greek. But see, Hercules is the Roman name for Heracles. It's not Greek, you guys. The name Hercules came hundreds of years after the myth of Heracles, and it was just an interpretation of the original Greek story. The Romans decided that Heracles was their favorite, they fucking loved him, and so they co-opted him, taking his Greek story, calling him Hercules, and keeping it for their own. A number of emperors in Rome identified with Hercules, it made them feel more powerful. This is the reason that that name, Hercules versus Heracles, has lived on so much more prolifically. Because, of course, the Romans basically built the world we now know. That's all to say, I'll be calling him Heracles, because I'm a purist, goddammit. But yeah, I mean, every piece of pop culture out there presents him as Greek with the name Hercules, so I'm sorry. Also, I'm not perfect. I've seen the Disney movie 100 times. I may slip up. Or maybe I'll just go between the two. Let's just see, shall we? I'm not responsible for the confusion, but I will apologize to you for it. Just know that the animated character, both from the movie and the awesome TV show that followed, Kevin Sorbo, Ryan Gosling, Kellan Lutz, The Rock. Sorry, I grew up in the 90s and early 2000s, and he will always be The Rock, and I will always wonder what he is cooking. All these people, all these actors, are playing Heracles. They just call them Hercules, because again, perpetuation, and it's all the Romans' fault. And with all that said, this is episode 16. Heracles, or Hercules, zero to hero, just like that. Heracles was born to Zeus and Alcmene, granddaughter of the brilliant and wonderful hero Perseus. One of the good ones. And as Wikipedia rightly points out, this made him both great-grandson and half-brother of the hero Perseus, because Zeus is gross and so things like that just happen. But first, let's start from the beginning. There's a man named Electrion. He's the king of Mycenae, and he's the son of Perseus and Andromeda. He went to war with the Teleboans. See, the Teleboans had killed his sons and stolen his cattle. And we know how the Greeks feel about stolen cattle. Seriously, it's come up a lot. People were always stealing cows. While he was gone, he left his trusted nephew, Amphitryon, in charge of Mycenae. And as a little pretty disturbing, patriarchy-centric bonus, Amphitryon got, for looking after Mycenae while he was away, well, he got Electrion's daughter, Alcmene. And he could just marry her. So it's like, here, have this woman, even though she probably doesn't want you, and also, P.S., she's your cousin. No big. But on top of that, there was another weird and patriarchy-centric trick. See, Amphitryon had to leave Alcmene a virgin while Electrion was away. While on top of being troublingly invasive of Alcmene's freedom to do what the fuck she wants, it's just asking for trouble in terms of Greek mythology. You can just see something tricky coming down the pike. Basically, he said that there would be no sex until Electrion's sons, Alcmene's brothers, had been avenged. After some time, Electrion found the missing cattle. He hadn't yet avenged his son's deaths, but hey, he found the cows. He called for Amphitryon to help him drive the cows back to Mycenae, and during this herding, one of the cows went a bit cray, and Amphitryon threw his club at it, because animal cruelty, and also stupidity, because it bounced off the cow and hit Electryon, killing him. And as we've learned over the past few episodes, you're an outcast when you kill someone. You're not, like, a criminal? That'd be crazy. No, you just have to leave town. So Amphitryon and Alcmene had to leave Mycenae, and they headed to Thebes. And if you thought the death of Electryon meant that Amphitryon and Alcmene could go ahead and have sex, you would be wrong. See, those brothers of hers still needed to be avenged, and now it was up to Amphitryon. So he went to Creon, king of Thebes. This being, yes, the Creon of the Oedipus story and not the Creon of the Medea story, because too many Creons. He went to Creon for help, but Creon was a hint busy. See, there was a fox causing major trouble in Thebes. This seems like a lot easier to deal with than the Sphinx that they had a while back, but I guess this fox was still quite problematic. Every month, they would send a man out to get rid of the fox, and he would never come back, which makes me think they should have sent a woman, but what do I know? So Creon would help Amphitryon, but only once that tricky fox had been dealt with. Now, about this time, a man named Cephalus showed up. Cephalus came from Athens, where he had also accidentally killed someone, and so he had also headed to Thebes for purification, just like Amphitryon. There's a pattern, it's weird. Cephalus had a dog, a hound, who was infallible in some way. I'll try to cover this story soon so maybe we can understand how and why this dog was fancier than other dogs, but he was. So Cephalus sent his infallible dog against this fox who was also infallible in some way. There's lots of fancy schmancy animals here, I don't totally understand it. But since both these animals were infallible, the dog couldn't catch the fox, they just kept going around and around and around. And finally, Zeus was like, the fuck is going on here? So he just turned both animals into stone. So now Creon could help Amphitryon avenge the death of Electryon's sons. There's so many eons, I don't even know how to handle it. They went against the Teleboans, but Teleboans had another piece of weird Greek mythology magic on their side. They couldn't be defeated unless their king was defeated, and their king had magic golden hair that kept him alive. This is weird, but we're going with it. As is the norm in Greek mythology, the king's daughter saw Amphitryon and immediately fell in love with him, and as a result, she decided to betray her father, cutting off his hair and killing him. Because we know that's exactly how women are, always falling in love with strangers and killing their fathers for those strangers. Typical. So Amphitryon had finally avenged the death of Alcmene's brothers, and finally he could have sex with his wife. He returned to Alcmene, and she was excited. So I guess she ended up loving this dude that she was forced to marry, or at least the myth wants us to believe that. She and her husband had sex. Finally. Only, as it turns out, this was not her husband. So Amphitryon was still away, wherever he defeated those Teleboans, and it was actually Zeus disguised as Amphitryon. He disguised himself as Alcmene's husband so that he could seduce her, which, even by Zeus's very, very low standards, is skeezy. And later that night, Amphitryon himself actually did return home, and so Alcmene actually then did also have sex with her husband, and because ancient Greek myths erred on the side of crazy, Alcmene ended up being pregnant with Heracles, son of Zeus, and Iphicles, son of Amphitryon. They were twins, except one was a demigod with a different father. Sucks to be Iphicles. And you'll never guess, but weirdly enough, Hera found out about Zeus's creepy seduction of Alcmene, and she learned that there was yet another illegitimate child of Zeus that would be born. She was, as per usual, less than thrilled. I mean, could he fuck off already and stop causing her so much grief? These two are a vicious cycle. Zeus is awful to Hera, and so Hera is awful to the women Zeus fucks, and then Zeus goes and fucks more women. It never ends. On the upside here, actually, Hera is about to be awful to a man and not a woman, so progress. It's really too bad there was no ancient Greek mythological divorce. I think it would have done a world of good. Literally. So again, Hera knows, she's pissed. Shocker. And on the night that the twins, Heracles and Iphicles, were going to be born, Hera went to her husband. Knowing that Heracles was about to be born and be very powerful as the son of Zeus and the grandson, of Perseus, who was, of course, also the son of Zeus. And she went to Zeus to convince him to swear an oath that the descendant of Perseus being born that night would become High King. And no, I don't know what High King means, but it sounds like an ideal that one might want for themselves. But Hera did this knowing that not only would Heracles be born that night, but another baby, Eurystheus, who was also a descendant of Perseus, was going to be born as well. He was being born elsewhere. I don't know where. It's not pertinent. The point is, somewhere, another baby who was also related to Perseus was going to be born. Now that Zeus's oath had been sworn, Hera went straight to Alcmene, who was already in labor. She wanted to slow things down so that Heracles might be born the next day, making Eurystheus, who was not a child of Zeus's adultery, High King. Hera forces Eileithyia, goddess of labor and childbirth, to delay the birth. Meanwhile, Hera causes Eurystheus to be born prematurely. Eileithyia delays the birth for a while before Alcmene's servant, Galanthus, ultimately causes confusion or does it intentionally, it's not clear, but it's she who makes it so that Heracles was ultimately born and not stuck in Alcmene forever. And, dear listeners, this is when I answer my own question from the Hecate mini-myth. I didn't understand why Hera wanted Heracles' birth delayed, and there it is. See, we're all learning together. Now, Alcmene was no dummy. She feared Hera's wrath. She may have been no dummy, but she was willing to kill her child in order to keep Hera from punishing her, so she's no saint either. Alcmene exposed the baby Heracles. Now, as a reminder, exposure is the fancy term for leaving your baby out in the middle of nowhere for it to die by whatever means might befall it. This is what they tried to do with Oedipus before it failed pretty miserably. In this case, Athena comes across the baby Heracles, and feeling a strong desire for some dramatic irony, she brings the baby up to Mount Olympus and gives it to Hera herself, who, unknowingly, nurses him as her own. This is what they don't tell you in the Disney version, am I right? So Hera nurses the baby, but apparently he was a little too keen, maybe went a little hard on the goddess nips, and she ended up pushing him away at one point. Between the startled baby and the unprepared nips, Hera's milk splatters across the sky and forms the Milky Way. So, you know, space facts. After nursing with Hera for a while, Athena brings the baby back down to Earth, and he's ultimately raised by his parents, or mother and stepfather, I guess. And I guess they took him back with no questions asked, but not before he had gained mega supernatural powers from all that goddess breast milk. And Heracles didn't always have that name, either. He was born by the name Alcides, but was renamed Heracles in an effort to make Hera happy by using her name. It didn't work. The twins were 8 months old when Hera made her first move against them. She sent two snakes into their crib. Iphicles cried in fear because that's fucking scary and they're babies. I'd have lost my shit too, Iphicles. But Heracles, with his Hera-provided super strength, grabs the snakes and strangles them. And now, all I can see is baby Herc in the Disney movie when he grabs the snakes and makes their heads knock each other out. Would have never guessed that that was based on the real myth. Heracles was found by his nurse playing with the dead snakes as if they were toys, so she probably never went near him again, or maybe that's just me projecting. His stepfather, Amphitryon, was so surprised at this baby's strength and general bravery that he called on the prophet Tiresias. You remember the one, blind, got a little mouthy with Oedipus? I could just picture the conversation. Tiresias, my baby, like, baby, killed two snakes with his bare hands. I mean, is that normal? Tiresias tells Amphitryon that Heracles was destined for an unusual future, that he would defeat many a monster. And after accidentally killing his music teacher because he was just too damn strong, Heracles was sent to herd cattle for a while. Maybe I listened to too much My Favorite Murder, but this sounds a bit like one too many of those stories. I think Heracles might have ended up a serial killer if he were around today. Maybe he was even hit on the head at some point. But I digress. While he was banished and was herding cattle on a mountainside, Heracles ends up killing a lion that was eating the cattle. The king of the region, whose cows had been the ones getting eaten, is super psyched by this. And when men who have daughters are happy with a random man who's just dropped by, you know things are going to go well. This king, Thespius, had 50 daughters. 50. That's 50. And what does he do? Well, obviously, he tells Heracles that as a thank you for killing a lion, he can have sex with all of his daughters. All 50 of them. Zero to hero indeed. Also gross. Sorry guys, Heracles is kinda gross. Just a hint different from how we know him from the animated classic. I don't think Marissa from the OC's dad would have signed on if this was the story being told. Heracles moves back to Thebes a couple years later. He's allowed back because he does a favor for King Creon. He gets him out of a really annoying annual payment of 100 oxen that Creon had to deal with. Basically, he waged a battle against the people asking for the 100 oxen and defeats them. Oh, and Amphitryon died in that battle too, but, you know, he was only the stepfather. Who cares about him? Am I right? So now that Heracles is allowed back to Thebes and Creon is happy with him, I think you could imagine what's coming. See, Creon had a daughter. And guess what? You'll never guess. Creon tells Heracles that he could marry his daughter. Because seriously, what are women for if not property you can give away? Heracles marries Megara, princess of Thebes. And yes, that is something vaguely right about the Disney movie. Vaguely. They were married for a few years, and they had a bunch of kids, and were happy. And as the mythology book I'm reading for this story says, Megara, quote, proved to be a loyal wife and sensible mother. This book was written by a man, as you might have guessed. Aside from some very annoying comments like this, it's quite a good source. There's info about it in the episode description. So Heracles and Megara are married for years, they have so many kids, they're just a happy family, just living the life, and all is well. But unfortunately, Hera was still waging her war on Heracles, and One day, she causes him to lose his fucking mind. In his madness, he goes from room to room in his house and kills all the children he has with Megara and Megara herself. See, Hera had convinced him that they were all enemies, and of course in ancient Greece you just straight up murder your enemies. Athena sees what's going on and wants to help. Athena always wanting to help male heroes, she's rarely a fan of the ladies. She goes down to Heracles and she hits him on the head with a rock. She knocks him out and when he comes to, he's back to normal. Except, legit, everyone is dead. His whole family. He wakes up to the bloody, super gross and depressing bodies of his children and his wife. Not quite the Disney romance there. But at least they got the name Megara right, I guess. At this point, Heracles is pretty depressed. I wonder why. And as much as I wish Disney were true, there are no singing muses, nor Danny DeVito-voiced satyrs teaching hero duties. Oh, Disney, the expectations you give us! Anyway, our Heracles has had a tricky life up to this point, and for the most part it's thanks to Hera and how much she loathes all of Zeus's many, many love children. God, what's with that word, love child? It's awful. Describes nothing. I apologize for using it. This is why I always find it very entertaining watching the movie Hercules, which, of course, I love. But my favorite thing is how Hera dotes on Hercules. The little baby guy given Pegasus by his doting parents. It's adorable. It's hilariously off base, but adorable. And spoilies, there is no Pegasus in this story. Because that's not a thing for Heracles. That'd be old Bellerophon. We'll cover him soon enough. So at this point, Heracles is reeling from waking up and realizing he's basically killed everyone. I mean, not something I'd like to wake up to. It seems legit that he'd be upset. He's distraught and he heads to the Oracle at Delphi to seek Apollo's advice on what the hell to do with his life now. The Oracle tells him that he has to serve his cousin Eurystheus. That would be the child that was born just before Heracles himself. The child that Hera wanted to make High King. Again, whatever that means. I think he's just a king. It was Wikipedia that said High King. I just liked it so I could make a joke. So Heracles is not super fond of Eurystheus in general, given he holds Heracles' rightful crown. So he's told that he must serve Eurystheus for 12 years, and during those 12 years, he has to do any and everything Eurystheus orders. So I think you know that this is going to go well. And not only this, but the gods also told Eurystheus that he must assign super duper hard labors to Heracles. Like, does this seem impossible? Great, tell Heracles to do it. That's essentially Eurystheus' mandate. Have Heracles do the impossible. Zero to hero, just like that. But what Heracles doesn't know is that the gods plan to also make him immortal once he's completed these 12 years of service. And whatever labors Eurystheus assigns to him, those are to prove that he is indeed worthy to be a god and be immortal. Once completed, that'll be it. So, bonus, but Heracles doesn't actually know this. Heracles heads to Eurystheus. Guys, this word is awful. Greeks are nothing if not obedient to the oracle. And Eurystheus began to assign Heracles his labors. The first few take place in the Peloponnese. That's the peninsula region in southern Greece. It's separated from the mainland by the isthmus. A pointless fact that simply allowed me to use the word isthmus. You're welcome. The Peloponnese was the home of Sparta and the oh-so-famous Peloponnesian War, written about by Thucydides and the movie 300. At this time, the Peloponnese was a bit wild and dangerous, arguably as was the rest of Greece, but here's Eurystheus's thinking. What an awesome opportunity I have to make it safer. There's a super strong hero who has to do anything I want. So that's where everything began for Heracles. First up, Eurystheus demands the hide of a lion, which is super depressing, but what can you do? And it's not just any lion that Eurystheus wants. No, it is a particular lion that has been terrifying the hills of nearby Nemea. Sound familiar? Yes, this is the Nemean lion. Offspring of the chimera and super duper strong, near impossible to kill. And why was it impossible to kill? Well, Heracles' old friend Hera had raised it specifically to be a trial for Heracles. And with that poorly prepared cliffhanger, I leave you. Next week, how does Heracles defeat a lion whose skin is impenetrable? How will he handle it when his sword simply bends when he stabs it into the side of this lion? Will he go the distance? We'll see. Thank you all for listening. I'm going to admit something to you. Even I don't know that much about the true stories of Heracles. My own knowledge is based on Hercules, the animated movie, and the resulting TV show, so I'm learning along with you. So far, I question the use of Megara in the movie. I think they should have just given her another name. Better to make it wrong than suggest that after the movie ended in its so-called happily ever after, that Herc went on to go crazy and slaughter Meg and their children. But hey, what can you do? I was just a kid. And I'll point out for anyone who watched the movie's resulting TV show about young Hercules' adventures in ancient Greek high school, his best friend in the show is a boy by the name of Icarus. Speaking of characters with tragic true stories. Also, I just watched Blade Runner 2049, which, one, was amazing, and two, made me incredibly motivated to watch the young Hercules TV show that famously beautiful and wonderful Canadian Ryan Gosling starred in as a youth. I will update you all as I heed this desire because I think it's on Netflix. Thank God for that. You're all magnificent. Kindly rate and review on iTunes if you haven't already. It makes me happy and helps other nerds find me. And I know we all want to share the myth nerd love with one another. I'm Liv. I can go the distance, and I love this shit.